Alison Forrest speaking, interviewing Mrs. Laura Legge for the Law Society. Today is the 21st of July 2004. This is interview number 3. Now, today I wanted to ask you about your experiences as a bencher and treasurer for the Law Society of Upper Canada, and I wanted to start first with your experiences as a bencher. So what year were you first elected as bencher?
1975.
And had you put your name forward previously, or was that the first time that you'd stood for nomination?
No, that was the first time.
First time. And I was wondering why you decided to run for bencher.
I can't answer that, I don't know.
Okay.
Well, that's not quite true. For a number of years, we had wanted to have a woman bencher,
right,
and had never been successful. Margaret Heinemann had almost made it, and should have been. In the days when there were 15 benchers, she was number 16.
Right.
And when one of the benchers was appointed to the bench.
Okay, to continue.
Margaret Heinemann should have moved in, but there was no requirement that the bencher with the next number of votes be moved in, so they
right.
skipped her and appointed a man.
Right.
And they then changed the rules or the legislation, I don't know which, so that now the next person in line
mm-hmm.
for the next number of votes automatically becomes a bencher.
Oh, okay.
So in 1975, I decided to run. The women wanted to have a bencher, and I decided that perhaps I had a chance because I had been practicing for some time.
Yes.
And I knew a lot of lawyers, and transpired that that was so. I was elected.
Great. When would the Margaret Heinemann incident have been? When would she have been running?
It was in the 1960s.
Right.
It was in the 1960s.
Right. Okay, thanks. Prior to becoming a bencher, had you had any dealings with the Law Society other than your ordinary professional?
No.
So nothing to ease you into the role
no.
of bencher?
No.
And you knew some of the benchers already at this time. Who were they? You said some of them you had actually graduated with, so that they were the your
as a bencher, Bob Rutherford, and Redmond O'Brien.
Right.
And I don't know who else.
Right. I was wondering, in terms of your life, your life, whether the timing of running for bencher coincided with the time in your life when you had more availability of time for whatever reason,
yes.
work or
my children were all in university, or
right.
yes, they were all in university in 1975. Only one of them was living at home,
right.
so I had more time. I had more personal time.
Right.
Yes.
And we'll be discussing this, as we said in the next interview, the nature of your non-legal committee work, but I was wondering if you were committed otherwise to other committees at this point in time as well, or if that had eased you as well.
1975, I was very active in a woman's service club, the Sir Optimus Club. As a matter of fact, I was the president of that year.
Right.
And yes, I was very busy.
Right. But nonetheless, you found the time. okay, so just to return to your actual nomination to bencher, I was wondering how you go about or how one goes about achieving support for nomination, so the mechanics of
there's no problem being nominated. As I recall, my nomination papers, 10 male friends nominated me.
Right.
And it was really a lot of fun. There was great enthusiasm amongst my male colleagues who knew me as a lawyer. And in March of 1975, I went off to England and didn't realize that I was supposed to be campaigning. I went to England to visit my daughter, who was a student at Cambridge. And my husband sent out letters to lawyers he knew, but the people who, you're elected a venture because people who know you vote for you.
Yes.
And ask their friends to vote for you.
Right.
Because they think, hopefully they think you will do a good job in governing the profession.
Yes. So you headed off to England and didn't realize you were supposed to be campaigning. Was anybody at home doing work for you?
Well, my husband was here.
And was he actively?
Well, yes, he did. He sent out letters, which I wasn't aware that he was doing it, but he did.
Right.
Which was very nice of him.
And you said that a lot of people already knew you at this point in your professional career.
I've been practicing since 1948, and I have hundreds of lawyers.
Yes. Were you aware of who or which organizations may have supported you?
No. There were really no organizations who supported me.
Right. So individual lawyers.
Yes. One very good friend that we had was John Perry, who was a senior partner at McCarthy & McCarthy. And John certainly was a great support and campaigned for me.
Right.
And campaigned at McCarthy & McCarthy. Mm-hmm. I heard, he didn't tell me, but one of the lawyers there said he stood up at a meeting and asked them to vote for me.
All right.
He is a very good friend.
Yes.
Marvelous human being.
So you weren't here. I was going to ask if in some way you had indicated what your interests and priorities were for the Law Society, but I guess if people knew you, then they would know what it was that you represented.
Well, you see, this is, you become a venture of the Law Society, not in the, in with your agenda, but in the interest, in the public interest.
Yes.
And I always knew that I was there. And it was always my view that I was going to go to see that the public was provided with honest, competent lawyers.
Yes.
And I was always concerned that lawyers serve the public well.
Yes.
And that was my agenda.
Right. Now, we had talked about this before, that you've attracted a great deal of public interest over the years in your career as a lawyer, as a woman, and then as a wife and mother. Did the degree of interest in you change or increase once you became a bencher?
Well, I suppose so. I was never interested in a public profile, so I was asked to speak a great deal to various groups, which I did. I gave many speeches.
Yes.
Yes, it did change. People were interested, but they wouldn't be the slightest bit interested today, but it was sort of a situation where were the first woman there, and so they were interested in some woman who was married and a mother was doing this. Today they wouldn't pay the slightest attention to it.
Right.
Because it's now old hat.
When was the next woman bench elected? Was that
4 years later?
4 years later.
Yes,
was that the lady bench?
Oh. And Mary. Sorry, I'm having a mental break. Two benchers, two women were elected.
And at the time that you were elected a bencher, there wouldn't have been a separate room for women benchers because there was just you, I guess.
No. No, it was interesting. We used the barrister's robing room, which was a very
right.
small room, and they very shortly after I was elected had a separate room for women benchers.
Mm-hmm.
And I was terribly amused. They had 8 lockers, and I said, "You're silly, because in very few years there will be many women benchers."
Yes.
Because there were so many women who were beginning to be called to the bar.
Mm-hmm.
And of course I was right.
Yes.
I think they had about 30 lockers.
Yes, that's right. Well, it probably seemed like a large number at the time, perhaps. In terms of the expectations of benchers, time commitment and attendance, committee work, what were those expectations?
I don't know what the expectations were, but I can tell you that from the time I was elected, I was spending 25% of my days on Law Society work at Osgoode Hall.
This is your work day?
Yes.
Yes.
25. I estimated at least a week of every month was spent at convocation committees or on discipline hearings.
Mm.
At least a week a month.
It's a very heavy commitment.
Sometimes it was more than that.
Right. Other than your attendance, convocation, and committee work, were there any other formal engagements as a bencher that you were required to attend?
No.
And did you find the time commitment onerous in terms of the other responsibilities that you had? Was that a...
Well, it didn't bother me. I suppose it was onerous, but it wasn't a... I enjoyed what I was doing
yes.
everywhere, so it was no effort.
Sure. So if it was 25% of your work time, how did you fit your other work commitments into this? Did you have to ease them off, or how did you go about?
No, I worked evenings. I would work until midnight many evenings during the week. I worked Saturdays.
Right.
I would
right.
work Sundays.
Right.
You just extended your day and your work time.
Right. And the committees that you were on as a bencher, were you able to choose the committee work that you were involved in out of interest? Or were there other ways that you became a member of the committee?
I can't remember, but I was on unauthorized practice, which was of great interest to me. I was on the admissions committee, which was of interest to me, and I was on, I can't remember what other committees, but...
Small firms.
Yes,
yeah.
And I was interested in
yes.
those.
Yes.
And I think that in my, as a lawyer in a small firm, I realized the danger of persons giving legal advice who weren't authorized to do it. I saw some
yes.
of the problems that arose.
Right. In your early years as a bencher, I was wondering if there was a particular moment when you raised an issue that was important to you.
No.
No. Now, this is 31 years ago when you were first elected a bencher. Could you describe the formality of the proceedings at that time? Has it changed since?
29 years ago, if I may correct you.
Oh, yes. I'm sorry.
Yes.
My math is not working today.
Yes. No, things were conducted much the same as they are now. There's
right.
very little change.
Right.
It was, convocation was very formal, and many meetings were not quite as formal as convocation, but it's much the same debate, and very little change in the way meetings are conducted.
Right. I was going to ask you if the sheer numbers, there have been more people in convocation over that time, like in choice of being on the board.
One of the changes that I have noticed in the early days, of course, the convocation was not open to the public.
Right.
The level of debate, in my view, was a much higher level of debate.
Right.
People were not playing for the press, and they weren't playing for an audience.
Right.
They spoke succinctly and well, they got to the point. They weren't putting on a show for anybody. It was to contribute to the discussion and the debate, and there was a very high level of debate. And I have observed that there is a lot of time wasted because so many benchers feel that they must speak.
Right.
And in those days, if everything had been said, you didn't need to get up and speak.
Yes.
You showed your support or non-support by your vote when everything had been said and the arguments had been made. That is one sorry change I see in convocation.
Yes.
But we've had some excellent treasurers in recent years who have moved convocation along and have stopped a lot of waste of time.
Right. Now, somebody had told me that in convocation itself, particular benches always sit in the same place, and I was wondering if you had a place that you always sat in.
Well, former treasurers, that's just a tradition. We always, as soon as you have stopped being treasurer, you don't sit around the table, you sit back against the wall, and usually the east wall somewhere.
Right.
So we all sit together on the east wall.
And somebody sits under their portrait. Is that you, or is that
no?
That wouldn't be you. Yes, it's,
no.
Perhaps it's Mr. O'Brien. And you always sit in the same place. Is that kind of recognized as no?
Just same generally. Yes. Yes.
Okay. How would you have described your participation in discussion at convocation? Were you fairly vocal? Or?
No. Never have been. I only speak if I have something to contribute. I have never felt compelled to speak uselessly. I have never felt compelled to speak to be heard, but if I have something to say, I certainly say it.
Yes.
So, and on occasion, I have been very vocal, but usually I only speak if I have what I consider something important.
Right. Would you be one of the few solicitors in?
Yes.
Yes.
Yes. Don't know now, but there were very few of us when I was first elected.
Yes.
The out-of-town benchers tend to be solicitors.
Right.
You know, John Powell and Gordon Farquharson were more solicitors from out of town.
Right. Is there a difference in the way they participate?
I don't think so. I never detected any difference. No, I don't think so.
And did you find over the years that there were benchers who tended to share your views fairly consistently?
Yes, that's
so
true.
Kind of groups. Right.
Yes. One lay bencher who shared my views always was June Caldwell.
Oh, right.
I think everyone was a bit surprised, but June Caldwell was a very sensible and a very good lay manager.
Yes.
It was a pity she only stayed for 4 years.
Right.
In my view.
Right. And were there any others that you'd say fairly consistently shared your views?
No, I don't think so. I never thought much about it.
Right. Now, sitting, I say you're close to 30 years, so I guess I could do the math at that point. You sat in the same room with a number of the same people for many years.
Yes.
You must know one another quite well. So you're there to work, but how would you describe the atmosphere of convocation?
It's very pleasant, collegial.
Mm-hmm.
You're not there generally. I think the atmosphere is generally that you're there for a higher purpose. You're not
yes.
there for yourself.
No.
You're there to see that the profession is well governed. And the public interest is paramount.
Yes.
Absolutely.
Yes. I wanted to ask you, what do you perceive the role of convocation to be? So I guess you really just answered that. So it's protection of the public.
It is indeed. We are not, and I said it when I was treasurer, we are not a union for lawyers. We are there to see that the public, that the profession is governed so that the public has access. I'm very concerned about access to justice, and
yes.
that people have access to affordable legal services.
Yes.
And honest lawyers and competent lawyers.
Yes. So in terms of achieving all of those things, what would the hardest or most difficult be of convocation towards achieving those goals? What would be the most difficult part for convocation towards achieving those goals?
I'm afraid I can't answer that question because I don't think that convocation the mentors work on it consistently.
Yes. Sure. Now, convocation has changed a great deal since you were first elected a bencher. We were talking about greater numbers of benchers. There are now lay benchers.
Well, there are no more elected benchers, the same number of elected benchers,
right.
but there are more lay benchers. There were
right.
four. We now have 8 lay benchers, and
mm-hmm.
we have 4 then.
Right.
Yeah.
And possibly a more diverse group of lawyers, even just more women.
Yes.
So has that changed convocation at all, or is it essentially the same?
I don't think mm-hmm. it's to my mind, there isn't a perceptible change.
Mm-hmm.
The only change, as I said earlier, was in the debates. I think that the level of debates isn't as high as it was when we had a closed convocation.
Right.
To speak because
yes.
the audience out there
right.
needed to hear them.
I want now to turn to your years as treasurer. And you were elected treasurer at Law Society of Canada in 1983, is that right?
Correct.
And that was for 2 years.
You're elected for 1 year,
mm-hmm.
and then in 1984, June, I was re-elected for 1 more year.
Right, okay. And I guess I wanted to ask you pretty much the same question as when I was asking about being a mentor, what motivated you to run for future.
There was a reason there. I was very concerned because there had been a proposal and legislation had been drafted to change the discipline process. And it was, the proposal was the discipline committee would make the final, the ultimate decision to disbar. And the only appeal from that committee would be to the courts. And I felt that this was wrong. And I was very concerned about that. And I felt the only way that I could have any influence to stop it would be if I became the treasurer.
Right.
And that was what I ran as treasurer.
Right.
And when I became treasurer, Attorney General called me, who was Roy McMurtry, now Chief Justice, and I have great praise for his role as Attorney General while I was Treasurer. He was wonderful.
So he was over the 2 years, both years?
Yes, he was. He was the Attorney General for the 2 years, and he was cooperative, sensible. All my secretary at the Law Society would call his secretary and say I had a problem, and within an hour there would be a call back, you know, when could I meet him? He would make himself available. And when I was elected treasurer, within 3 days he telephoned me and said he would like to see me, and he wanted to discuss the legislation that was before government, and I said I want to talk to you about it because I'm very much opposed to it.
Yes.
And I felt that it shouldn't go from the committee to the courts.
Mm-hmm.
And he concurred, and that was stopped.
Right.
And now, of course, we do have amendments since then, but it's very sensible because it goes from the 3-man panel of convocation to an appeal panel of, I guess it's 10 benchers, which is very sensible.
Yes.
And you can then, if you want to appeal from, you've had an appeal.
Yes.
If you want to appeal, you can then go to the court, but it
right.
doesn't go immediately to the courts.
Right.
Because the way the proposal back in 1983, the courts would have been clogged with every lawyer who was disciplined going over to the original court.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
So that, you want to know why I wanted to be treasurer, that's why.
Mm-hmm. Was there any other reason other than...
That was it?
No, sorry. Along the same lines, but any other reason other than just sheer numbers of lawyers going on appeal to the courts, or was it appropriate for
we are, the benchers are elected to govern the profession.
Yes, that's
and
right.
And we were going to give up
yes
our autonomy.
Yes.
We were going to turn it over to the courts.
Right.
Which I understand in many states of the United States is where discipline of the profession is.
Right.
And I felt that we were competent to
yes.
discipline ourselves.
Yes. Okay, getting back to actually being elected, were you involved in this campaign? You weren't in the country the last time when you became bencher. Were you in any way?
In those years, when you ran as treasurer, there was no campaign.
Right.
We did not campaign.
Right.
Although I certainly didn't.
Right.
I just told people I was running.
Mm-hmm.
And I was nominated, and they could vote
right.
for me or not.
Right.
I asked no one to support me.
Right.
And we didn't in those years. It just wasn't done.
Right. Okay. Do you have any idea who your main supporters were? Were they individuals again, or was there maybe small firm representation?
There were 51 benchers, four who were voted. That's benchers
mm-hmm.
and former treasurers
mm-hmm.
and attorneys general. Then voted.
Right.
There were four women, and And I do know that of the four women, there were two lay benchers,
right,
and two elected benchers. And the two lay benchers voted for me, and one of the elected benchers were
right.
women, and one elected woman did not vote for me.
Right.
And you knew this, and it was all right.
Yes.
It was agreed. So 31 ventures voted for me, and 16 voted for Pierre Genet. There were 47 voted.
Right.
And Pierre was a wonderful fellow, but the problem was he had only been a venture for 2 years,
mm-hmm.
and he should not have been running as to be treasurer. He hadn't
right.
been there long enough.
Right.
And he, after me, he did become the treasurer.
Yes. How do they actually announce?
No, they just read out in convocation who
mm-hmm.
the nominations are for
right.
treasurer, and then we have a vote.
Right.
And then the votes are counted, and
mm-hmm.
they come in, and the secretary gives the tally.
Right.
In convocation.
Right. Mm-hmm. And how did you feel when you made treasurer?
I don't know. I suppose it was a bit exciting.
Right.
To be perfectly candid with you, I felt terribly sorry for Pierre Genet.
Right.
And my election was very much tempered with my heart going out to Pierre, who was a friend of mine and
yes.
a wonderful fellow. And it was sort of sad. And I thought that the people who had persuaded him to run were very ill-advised, because
yes.
the ventures, and the only reason he wasn't elected was because he had been there such a short time.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know,
we're
all friends, and
mm-hmm.
it was too bad. However, that's life.
And once you're actually made treasurer, is there a swearing-in ceremony?
No,
nothing of that sort. There's
sit
no
in the
public.
Chair and start running convocation.
So did you get any assistance from previous treasurers or the previous treasurer?
Very
to
much
take
so.
Over?
I had, whenever there was a serious problem, I could call on Brendan O'Brien,
mm-hmm.
who was absolutely wonderful. The other person, I had sort of an executive committee of my own. There was John Robinette, Brendan O'Brien,
mm-hmm.
Stuart Tom, who was just marvelous. They
mm-hmm.
were three former treasurers. Barry Pepper,
mm-hmm.
and I could call any of them any hour of the day or night, and
mm-hmm.
they would be in my office within 10 minutes to help me.
Right.
And they were just wonderful. George Finlayson, but he was very shortly elected to the
mm-hmm.
bench,
mm-hmm.
or appointed to the bench.
Yes.
And but even the former treasurers who were judges, you
mm-hmm.
know, would offer their advice or assistance.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
I remember William Howland, who was the Chief Justice,
right.
who was wonderful. And they helped. And you have to.
Yes.
Seek advice from people who've been there before.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And I remember one problem, I forget what the problem was, and within half an hour, Stuart Tom, Brendan O'Brien, and Barry Pepper were all in my office.
Mm-hmm.
Just like that, they dropped whatever they were doing and came
mm-hmm.
because it was a serious problem for the Law Society. Can you
yes.
give me advice?
Yes.
So, yes, I certainly did have advice from former treasurers and colleagues.
And not just when you went into office, but in an ongoing way?
Oh, yes,
yes,
at any time. They
yes.
If I wanted help, I would call them or they would
right.
offer advice.
Right. And do you think that's usual? Did you do that subsequently for incoming treasurers?
Well, I... we always offer our advice, and
mm-hmm.
we're there in convocation. And
yes.
I think that I think it's very important that former treasurers are there because mm-hmm. we've had the experience. And I think that life mentors are very important because mm-hmm. they've been there long enough and they
yes.
know and they've had the experience.
Yes.
So I think that it's a good system.
Mm-hmm. And you were talking earlier about your assistant, so or your secretary. So how important is a secretary to the role of treasurer?
Well, no, I had a, you know, a secretary who
yes.
did my typing and
yes.
opened my mail and brought
yes.
it around.
And then as a secretary.
I went down to the Law Society every morning. I was
mm-hmm.
there from 9 until about 1 at least every day,
mm-hmm.
longer. Then I would come to my office, and if I had to, I would go back.
Right.
And I would go through my mail. I answered my mail every day and dealt with problems that might have arisen.
Right.
And being a treasurer, even those years, in those years, was a full-time job.
Yes.
And I moved very quickly, and I think quickly, and I was able to do a lot of work in the 5 hours or 4 hours I was there.
Yes.
But then I frequently went back in the afternoon.
Right.
And there were many evening engagements.
Mm-hmm.
And if you were treasurer, you were called upon, in effect, to represent the Law Society.
Right.
And many other organizations.
Right.
Which was important to do.
Is that in the nature of public speaking or dinners? Or?
That's right. I did a lot of public speaking,
mm-hmm.
and I called it a lot of the law around the province.
Right.
And they still do a
mm-hmm.
lot of the county and district associations.
Right. So you visit.
Yes.
Right. So I think it's a lot of work. So other than those obligations, what were your official obligations as a treasurer while you were in the office 9 to 1? So you were answering correspondence?
Yes. Well, in those years, the treasurer was the chief executive officer of the
yes.
Law Society.
Yes.
And we were concerned somewhat with administration, although we had an under-treasurer,
mm-hmm.
who was Randall Dick, who was excellent. And we had Kenneth Jarvis, who had been a secretary for years. And Kenneth really looked after the professional matters. And Randall looked after the administration.
Right.
It was a wonderful division.
Mm-hmm.
And they were both there as advisors and helpers.
Mm-hmm.
And,
mm-hmm.
Even if I came back to my office, I was on the other end of the telephone, and if they had any problems, they could call me.
Right. And Ken Jarvis, at least, had been with the Law Society
for many years.
Yes. So he must have had it.
Yes.
And what about Randall Dick?
He had not been there. He'd only been there a few years, but then he had great experience as a deputy attorney general and deputy minister at Queen's Park.
Right.
So he was a very experienced administrator.
Yes.
And he also was very politically astute because he had been in Queen's Park.
Yes, yes. So again, you had good people
yeah.
to join.
Now there was one I do recall, and I think it should be on the record, we had one very serious political altercation of sorts. When I first became treasurer, I was summoned before a committee of the legislature to answer questions about something or other, and I forget what. And under the Law Society Act, we are answerable to the Attorney General.
Yes.
And it's through the Attorney General that we are answerable to the legislature. And this committee the legislature, and I forget which committee it was, summoned us to go to out to the legislature to answer questions about something. And I went, and one of the members there, and he was the member from Ottawa. How could I forget his name? Sean something or other, was exceedingly rude to me. You know, I answered their questions, but he was just vicious, you know. He would think that I was a member of the opposition. And the one thing that he was on about was our secret convocations, our secret meetings, as if there was some evil going on behind the closed doors. And you know, I had to be polite, and I couldn't lose my temper, although I would like to have. What was his name? Was it Cassidy? Perhaps. I still see him on TVO.
Okay.
He's interviewed every week. He's on a panel with Janet Ecker and I forget. He is the liberal from Ottawa. At any rate, I have often thought I'd like to see him sometime privately. But he was quite nasty about the laws, he said.
Right.
And my initial inclination was, you know, not to go, but the advice was, well, what did we have to lose? But it was the wrong forum. We should not have been there, and that hasn't happened since.
Right.
Now, the other problem when I was first elected, and we were getting very concerned about numbers of lawyers, and also I was concerned about the core courses in the law schools that were not being taught.
Right.
And I'm still concerned about it. And my one concern, and it's an ongoing concern, is the lack of teaching of equity,
right,
and legal history. And I tried very hard to do something about it. And when I was first elected, sorry, I'm having a chap who was a mentor, Mendes da Costa, Derek Mendes da Costa, was a professor at the University of Toronto Law School, and he was a mentor. And Derek actually came to me, and he too was concerned about the same things.
Right.
So I said, well, let's have a special committee established, and let's look at it and get some statistics and see what's going on. Well, very shortly after he started, he was appointed to the bench.
Right.
And Alan Rock was a young bencher, and I thought he was obviously quite talented, that he could take this on, and I spoke to him about it. But I'm sorry to say it didn't go anywhere.
Right.
Which is a pity. And every time the Law Society seems to ask the law schools to start teaching some basic courses, we get nowhere.
Right.
I couldn't get anywhere, and I tried very hard. And the one law school that has consistently taught, or have, I don't know if they still do or not, 12 basic courses was the University of Western Ontario.
Right.
And I think they're still teaching. I know they're still teaching equity law. And in my opinion, having been a lawyer for 56 years, if you don't understand the law of equity as well as the common law, how in the world can you be a lawyer in our legal system?
Yes.
And I think it's a real problem. And I think it's still a problem and an ongoing problem. But, and I blame the Law Society for with this one because we've allowed the law schools to teach a lot of courses that have really no relevance.
Right.
And you don't teach people to think like lawyers, you have to give them some tools with which to think.
Yes.
And I had one eminent law dean tell me that their only role was to teach people to think like lawyers, not to Marvin. You have to give them some basic tools to start thinking.
Yes.
However, so that was one of my very, very real concerns as treasurer.
Mm-hmm.
That was the education of lawyers. I must say I failed. I got nowhere and nothing has happened since. So,
was there support in convocation for this?
Well, there was some support, but
if there'd been more support, or was it, or does it, I guess what I'm asking is, does it have more to do with the relationship between universities and what they teach and convocation?
We cannot, as a law society, we cannot, and I always said this, we cannot tell the law schools what to teach, but we can say whom we will take into the bar admission course.
Yes.
And I said from the word go, we would not take people into the bar admission course who had not had some basic education in the law of equity, the law of evidence.
Right.
And the thing that absolutely appalled me was that I discovered that we had called to the bar the year before, I think it was 20 when I was elected treasurer, 22 students who had never studied evidence.
Mm-hmm.
Now you can't even be a solicitor without knowing some evidence.
Mm-hmm.
And so then they made evidence, they started teaching evidence for 2 weeks in the bar admission course. Well, that's not enough.
Right.
When I was in law school, it was a full year of evidence training. It's with you, it's part of your foundation as a lawyer.
Yes.
So this was a problem.
Mm-hmm.
And quite frankly, I think it's a problem that still exists.
You were speaking earlier about concerns about the numbers of lawyers also.
I was concerned then about the number of lawyers.
Mm-hmm.
Because I can see problems for the public.
Mm-hmm.
I also think it's quite unfair to be calling 1,200 or 1,000 young people to the bar and having them go through the onerous task and cost time of becoming lawyers, only to find that there is no work for them and no future for them. And I think that I could see us reaching a saturation point.
Mm-hmm.
And we are the only profession that doesn't control numbers.
Right.
Chartered accountants do, the doctors do, the dentists do.
Mm-hmm.
We don't. Now, I felt that our only approach was, is it in the public interest?
Mm-hmm.
And I think it is not in the public interest, because if you have too many lawyers, it's pretty simple to see you're going to have litigiousness.
Yes.
And we have. We've now reached that stage. And I'm told I don't do litigation, but I'm told that it's almost impossible now to settle a lawsuit. We have spurious lawsuits being commenced. I can see absolute changes in the way lawsuits are commenced. In the good old days, you would call up a lawyer and say, what about this?
Mm-hmm.
You could sit down, look at the file, realize there was no cause of action.
Mm-hmm.
Not today. The first thing you hear about it, no phone call, nothing. You receive a statement of claim.
Right.
And this is a complete change in the way law is practiced, and I put it down to the fact that there are too many lawyers chasing too little work.
Yes.
So we become like the Americans. We're very litigious. The courts are clogged, and I think this is not in the public interest. Now, I have tried about 5 years ago. I moved in convocation and I was seconded or vice versa by Gavin McKenzie that we at least look at this and see if there there's a problem hurting the public. And it was defeated. They wouldn't even look at it. So that's another problem that I think exists and is getting over.
Right.
And I think that when I hear that in your year, last year, there are many young lawyers well qualified who can't find employment, perhaps my concerns are being borne out, because now it's, I think it's quite unfair for us to say, well, go ahead, take your chance.
Mm-hmm.
You have invested too much money and too much time.
Now, another issue, you said that the issue of the discipline process first moved you to stand for treasurer. While you were treasurer, another issue that was raised within the Law Society at that time was advertising, the issue of lawyers advertising.
Right. Well, we had a wonderful debate about advertising.
Mm-hmm.
And we voted on it, and the vote was 50-50. So I had to cast the deciding vote, and
right.
I voted against advertising.
Right.
So it's now in advertising, it's now there, and people can advertise. I think it's demeaning to a profession to have advertising.
Mm-hmm.
And it's something that the only way you build a practice as a lawyer is by referrals. Now, I'll make the argument against it is, well, how is the public to know?
Mm-hmm.
Well, you know, you used to ask your bank manager, you've asked your relatives or your friends, and everybody has a lawyer
right.
to whom they referred their relatives and friends who needed a lawyer.
Mm-hmm.
Clients that are worthwhile do not come through advertising, I can tell you.
Right. So the vote, the hung vote, would that have been your first year? That would be 1983? Because Jabour was 1982.
I think it was in
so
83. Yes.
That would make sense, I guess.
Yes, I think
yeah.
so. It was
yeah.
very early on.
Yes. And, they were thinking of Jabour here, the Supreme Court case about advertising and law societies. There were other prominent law cases that occurred at around this time while you were treasurer, including Skopinka, the mobility issue.
Oh, yes, indeed. Yes, yes.
Brendan O'Brien appeared for the Law Society on that.
Yes.
Could you tell me something about that? That was while you were.
Was it while I was treasurer?
I believe
so.
It was 84.
I don't recall.
Okay.
I can't help you. Sorry.
Okay. Were there any other prominent law cases that came up at that time for the Law Society?
I'm not recalling. I'm sorry.
That's right. I'm going to be speaking to Mr. O'Brien about his role as acting as lawyer for the Law Society, but I wanted to ask you also how as a treasurer that worked. A case came up.
And how would you choose the lawyer to defend it?
Well, I guess what your role as treasurer would be in the involvement, I guess, of treasurer in any case that the Law Society is.
Really, what you wanted to make certain was that the lawyer representing the Law Society was
mm-hmm.
the best in the field.
Right.
And that is why we had Brendan O'Brien. And I remember one time, and I don't remember what the issue was, but we had to have the Attorney General of Ontario and the Law Society was
mm-hmm.
on the same side in some issue. And I spoke to Mr. McMurtry, and he named the lawyers
Right.
And strangely enough, there was one that I would have chosen that we had in common.
Right.
And so, you know, for whatever the problem was, you wanted the lawyer who was the leading person in that sort of law.
Yes.
To look after the interest of the law society, which was really looking after the interest of the public.
Right.
So, and Brendan O'Brien was an absolute. Very clever man.
Yes.
He's an excellent counsel.
Mm-hmm.
As was John Robinette, who
right.
was a brilliant man.
Did he represent the Law Society as well?
I don't know. Not in my day, he didn't.
Mm-hmm.
But apparently he had before.
Earlier, yes.
They're both former treasurers, both brilliant counsel.
Yes. And as treasurer, what was your involvement with working with council for? Was
there
a committee
little,
or?
Right. Very little.
Right.
You know, because they would work with, you know, they would get their instructions.
Yes.
They would work with the secretary and
right.
know about the
right.
problems.
This would be Ken Jones.
Yes.
Yes.
If, you know, if they wanted to know anything, of
right.
course they would
right.
speak to me. Ongoing. Now, as treasurer at that time, I was quite involved in the head of our discipline department, who was Steve. Sorry. Scandal about the apartment scams. You've heard of that. It was where they were the apartment flips.
Right.
And they would sell an apartment building for $5 million and immediately have a false. Or they would buy it for $5 million and then they would have a false. Offer and sell it for 10, and then they would go to these trust companies, there was
mm-hmm.
Seaway Trust and I forget the others, and would put mortgages on it for more than 5 million, 6
right.
or 7 million. Of course,
right.
the buildings were worth 5 million.
Yes.
They were mortgaged for more than they were worth,
right.
and they cleaned all the money up with the trust company. There was Morgan Trust, Seaway Trust, and I forget the others. The trust companies, of course, went bankrupt eventually because all the money was taken out and into the hands of the people who eventually went to prison. But we had lawyers who were involved in playing this game.
Mm.
And I was very much involved in giving instructions. And it was a field of law that I certainly understood
right.
what was going on. Steve Sheriff was the head of discipline.
I think I'm just going to. Right, this is the second tape interviewing Mrs. Laura Legge for the Law Society Treasurer's Project, interview number 3. Alison Forrest is speaking. It's the 21st of July 2004. Just to continue, we were talking about your experiences as Treasurer for the Law Society of Upper Canada. And we had covered a number of important issues that arose during your 2 years as treasurer. Now, just to move on from there, I was wondering also, having been a treasurer, and now as a life venture, if that has affected your role at all as venture, having been a former treasurer.
Oh yes, I think so. I think that you're more inclined to allow the elected ventures to carry the weight of debate and communication, for example, and you only intervene if you feel you have something significant to add.
Right.
You don't enter into the fray of the debate the way you would have when you were an elected treasurer, an elected mentor. But I personally feel more than my role is as an advisor there now.
Right.
Rather than an active participant.
Mm-hmm.
But I certainly, if there's something that I feel very strongly about, I would certainly speak.
Yes, yes. And you've consistently attended since you were treasurer?
I fell off for a few years, but I've been going back more regularly recently.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Great. Now, while you were treasurer, you met a number of notable people, and I was wondering if you could name some of those people. I believe Margaret Thatcher, you had a photo. Was that while you were treasurer?
That was when I was resurrected in 1988 for 2 months.
Oh, right.
When Dan Chilcott was appointed to the bench and Jack Brown was treasurer, was chairman of finance and should have assumed the role. And he called me and said he didn't want to be the shortest lived treasurer in history. And would I go back for 2 months? And I did.
Right.
And that was an interesting experience. Would you like to hear about it?
Yes, absolutely.
I was sitting in my office when I said I would only do it if there was nothing difficult coming up, and
mm-hmm.
I was assured that no, it was just a holding pattern for 2 months,
right.
Because I was very busy and I didn't have time. And I was sitting in my office, and Kenneth Jarvis telephoned me to say that he had heard from the British High Commissioner and that Mrs. Thatcher would be very pleased to become an honorary bencher. And I said, I don't recall that having been presented to convocation, because that
right.
sort of thing would have to be approved by convocation. And he said, no, it wasn't. The treasurer had on his own initiative sent
mm-hmm.
an invitation and then had gone off to the bench.
Right.
And I said, oh dear. And was when there was a great deal of political problems about apartheid in South Africa.
Mm-hmm.
And as you may recall, Mrs. Thatcher refused to boycott South Africa. And I said, telephone, you and Richard Tinsley, telephone every bencher, and I'll be home this evening and call me. There's a problem, I will call a special convocation.
Right.
Because I didn't want to do what had happened at Oxford, where it became world news that Oxford refused to have her speak or give her an honor.
Right.
And it was very insulting.
Yes.
So at about 9 o'clock that evening, he telephoned to say that they had telephoned, I think, 51 benchers, and 47 approved and 4 dissented.
Right.
I said, well, I think that's enough of a majority.
Mm-hmm.
Tomorrow we'll get a letter off to the High Commissioner and make arrangements.
Right.
Okay, Mrs. Thatcher become an honorary bencher. And it was an interesting thing. I had one bencher call me and say, couldn't do it. Well, don't tell me I can't do it. Convocation had spoken.
Yes.
Which I said. I wasn't doing it. Convocation was doing it. So the invitation went, and but the next morning the CBC telephoned me and said they had Mr. Morris Manning speaking as a constitutional expert, and that would I speak? Well, I was so annoyed. I said, yes, I would. And poor Morris Manning, I was so angry. He couldn't get a word in edgewise. And I said, we were not going to be another Oxford in an insulted visiting prime minister because of a very few vocal minority
mm-hmm.
who objected when
mm-hmm.
an overwhelming majority were delighted.
Yes.
In any event, this was very interesting. She came and was delightful, and Mr. Roland Michener, former Governor General, spoke, and
mm-hmm.
we had a lovely ceremony in the library at
mm-hmm.
Osmond Hall, and she was delightful. She spoke to every bencher there,
mm-hmm.
and that evening we had a dinner. She couldn't stay for the dinner, of course, but the British, I don't know whether it was the High Commissioner or the Consul General here, was at dinner with us,
right.
and he thanked me. They knew what was going on.
Yes.
For not embarrassing their Prime Minister.
Yes.
And I said, well, that isn't the function of this law society.
Mm-hmm.
I must tell you, the other thing, and I think you should know this, that absolutely shocked me. I received 13 letters, and they're somewhere on file at the Law Society,
mm-hmm.
from women
mm-hmm.
complaining because I was allowing her, you know, once again, it wasn't I, it was convocation, to become an honorary bencher. When she was all the horrible things that the militant feminist felt she was. I don't
right.
know what she was.
Right.
And I was so naive that I had no idea that they actually didn't like women who had made it on their own initiative.
Right.
And she, of course, had made it without reference to anybody except her own ability.
Mm-hmm.
I suppose she had behaved like a man when they got there without playing the gender card.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the letters actually threatened me that they would fix me. I was a little concerned about it. I forget who the woman lawyer was, but she worked for the attorney.
Lawyers.
These were lawyers, and she threatened me. She said, and she worked for the Attorney General, and I debated whether or not I should send the letter to the Attorney General, but the consensus that my advisors at the Law Society at the time was forget it. The lunatic fringe, would you turn it off, please? Yes? I was very hurt about that. I thought it was certainly no way for women to behave.
No.
And I only remember one of the women who had written to me. I have a wonderful mind. I am quite capable of putting out of my mind things that are unpleasant. That out of my mind. But it was the first time that I had ever cognizant of the fact that there was a group of women who professed to be concerned about women who really weren't.
Mm-hmm.
And I was somewhat shocked to
what
find out.
What do you think they were?
I guess they were just miserable, unhappy women.
Right.
Whatever their agenda was.
Right.
I couldn't imagine why they hated Margaret Thatcher, who was, you know, she was the Prime Minister of England, not of Canada.
Yes.
She made it on her own steam, no matter what you may have thought of her.
Mm-hmm.
Anyway, that was my experience with Margaret Thatcher.
Yeah. Were there any other notable people that you met?
When I was treasurer, the Honorable Roland Michener was a former Governor General,
mm-hmm.
and of course he was an honorary bencher, had been made an honorary bencher, and he used to come to every convocation.
Right.
He was a delightful person,
mm-hmm.
and a former Attorney General Arthur Wishart, who made a great contribution. And of course, the Honorable Alan Lawrence comes to every convocation now and is excellent. And those people come really in the public interest, and,
yes.
and they have a contribution to make.
Mm-hmm.
We're fortunate to have them.
Mm-hmm. We were just talking about Margaret Thatcher and we were talking about this a little bit earlier, your role as First Woman Treasurer. I wanted to ask you, perhaps I should have asked you this earlier, if you feel that it made it easier for women to follow you subsequently as a venture, as a treasurer?
Probably. I guess the men realized that just because you were a female, you weren't a monster, and that you weren't going to make a lot of waves.
Mm-hmm.
I never thought of myself, as I have said mm-hmm. before, as a woman lawyer. I always thought of myself as a lawyer.
Yes.
And when I became a venture, I thought of myself as a venture, and I was there to do a job as a venture.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that colleagues realized that I wasn't there with any hidden agenda but to do my part. They were, you know, it was acceptable.
Yes.
But I think that women, you know, as we have become and are becoming the majority in the profession, there will be no problem in women being, well, there hasn't been women being elected.
Yes.
Going to have to be elected on their own merit, just as
mm-hmm.
men have always been.
Mm-hmm. Now, I wanted to also ask you about the portrait that resides in Convocation that was done of you. Could you tell me about having it done?
Stuart Tom both felt that since I was the first woman elected as a bencher,
right.
I think they never crossed their mind that I might become a treasurer, that they should have a portrait of the first woman bencher.
Oh, I thought it was for treasurer. Right.
No. So they had it, and I was terribly embarrassed, and they insisted, and I kept putting it off. So I finally, I was only a bencher when that was
right.
Painted. But they did it because I was the first woman bencher.
Right.
And then, of course, when I became treasurer, there I had
portrait.
My portrait done. And then Ken Jarvis then wanted to do my head. He
yes.
was a sculptor,
yes.
so that's how that happened.
So that was for treasurer?
Yes.
Oh, right.
So
I was going to ask you how it was that you can have two. Right.
Yeah.
And who painted the portrait?
Keith Horn.
Mm-hmm. And did you know him before?
No.
Of him? No.
No, but he had done several of the former treasurers.
Right.
Stuart Todd, we did Brenda O'Brien.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know who else. I think he did George Finlayson.
Right. Right. And were you pleased with the result?
Well, one, that you can't judge your own portrait. It means nothing
right.
to you.
Right.
You're almost embarrassed to look at it.
Right.
Laura is an artist, and
mm-hmm.
an art historian was not pleased, but then your own family never is, because what they see in you is not what anyone else is.
Yes, that's true. And what about the head that was done?
Well, my husband likes it.
Mm-hmm.
I never bothered asking my children.
Mm-hmm. And is that, that's just outside Convocations as you come into Bench's entrance?
It's on the landing.
Landing, yes.
The top of the first one, Bench's stairs.
Right. Has it always been there? Was that?
It was there at one stage. It was moved. And I don't know why, but I just put back, Bob Armstrong put it back.
Right. And so every treasure then would have a painting done with them usually.
Yes.
Now I understand they rotate them. They rotate them in convocation as new objects are put
up. The rule always was that once a former treasurer has died, they remove his portrait from convocation.
Oh.
If he is sitting in convocation, then his portrait is in convocation.
Oh, okay.
So George Finlayson is in,
right.
Now comes to convocation, and his portrait is moved back in, as is Sidney Robbins.
Right.
Eventually, they will have to remove John Robinette's portrait,
right.
Because he has now been dead for many years.
Right.
However,
are there many traditions along that line?
Well, I can't think of them. The one wonderful tradition is that nobody really speaks in the dining room except the treasurer or anybody who is invited to speak.
Right.
Yeah, it's a lovely tradition.
Now, I wanted to ask you about awards or honours that you had received for your service to the Law Society and the legal community. Could you tell me something about those?
Yes, the Law Society gave me an honorary LLD.
Mm-hmm. And when would that have been? What year would that have been?
1980. I'm not certain. I think it was in 87 or 88.
Right, so after you had been treasurer.
Yes.
Those two times. And what did that involve? That was from the Law Society?
Yes, it was.
And was that a ceremony at the Law Society?
No, no, it was at a called the bar ceremony.
Mm-hmm. Oh, right. I noticed that outside your office door you have an Order of Ontario.
That was just awarded this year.
Yes.
Yes.
And what was that for in recognition of?
With my having been a nurse.
Mm-hmm.
What else did I do? I was a director of the Toronto Economic Development Corporation for a number of years, and I was also the chairman of that. I was a commissioner of the Parking Commission of Toronto and the chairman of that.
I'm sorry, what was that club?
It's a women's service club, and it
mm-hmm.
used to be a very active club that raised money for charities,
right.
For causes, mostly for women where there was a hiatus, and there was nobody to help them.
Right.
In the early days, we used to raise money for cancer
mm-hmm.
patients.
Mm-hmm.
However, it's sort of dying now, like all service clubs, there isn't a call for them. And then we did, what else did I do? I can't remember. I was the director of the Canada Life Insurance Company for 14 years, but that had nothing to do with public service. But it was that sort of thing.
Right. And can you think of any other awards or honors that you receive from our society.
Yeah.
No, they don't generally award many things, is that right?
No.
It's not a...
No.
And when you received the LLD, what did the recognition of your service to the legal community, what did it mean to you to receive that?
Well, I was very pleased. There's nothing so pleasant as being honored by your peers,
mm-hmm.
because they know.
Yes.
There was a citation read by Alan Rock. I should find it for you. It's around here somewhere. I don't know where it is. Let me look for it.
And now I wanted to move on to ask you about some of the committee work that you had served in while you've been a venture and treasurer, and I know that you have a particular interest in the role of small businesses and sole practitioners in the legal profession in Ontario, and I was wondering if you could tell me something about some of the work that is done by these committees and why it's important.
Well, I can tell you why that committee is very important. It is essential for the access to justice of the average citizen that the small law firms remain, because for probably 95% of the people of Ontario, their lawyer is in a firm of five or fewer. A lawyer who wants, or a citizen who wants to make a will or buy a house isn't going to go to a giant law firm.
Mm-hmm.
Small neighborhood lawyer.
Yes.
And those lawyers are really essential for the
mm-hmm.
access to justice. And this is why I feel very strongly that we must do anything we can to preserve their viability.
Yes.
And it's becoming more and more difficult with, this is another place where too many lawyers are back on the income, because
right.
if you have three lawyers where there should be one,
yes.
there's going to be a third of the income.
Yes.
And that is a bit of a problem, I think. I think numbers are hurting the small law firms.
Mm.
I may be wrong, I
right.
don't know, but I hope I'm wrong, but I don't think I am. And I think that this event essentially hurts the public.
Mm.
Because if a lawyer can't afford to keep his office open, then where is the public going to go?
Right.
And, you know, I find now, at my stage in life, I have people coming in saying, for goodness sake, keep on practicing. Life does have an end. And I, you know, my days are certainly numbered, but fortunately we have junior lawyers here. Carry on, but there are a lot of law firms that they just disappear.
Yes.
And it's too bad.
Yeah. Yeah.
So that is my interest in small law firms, because it's essential for the service, for legal services to the public,
mm-hmm.
we have small law firms.
Mm-hmm. Do you feel that working yourself in a small law firm, that assisted other practitioners who work in small businesses or sole practitioners to think about becoming a venture or?
I don't think so. It is a great financial sacrifice to
yes.
be a venture.
Yes.
And a very few small law firms. Small firm lawyers can afford
yes.
the time.
Yes.
I was very fortunate. My husband is a lawyer, and I was, you know, I didn't even think of becoming a venture until I had been a lawyer for 28 years.
Mm-hmm.
And these young lawyers who think they can become ventures when they've been lawyers for 5 or 10 years, which some of them have, they have no idea what they're getting into, and they shouldn't be running.
Mm-hmm.
For two reasons, they haven't hit the life experience, they
right.
haven't had the experience in the profession,
mm-hmm.
and they can't afford it.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. So, and in the days gone by, nobody tried to become a venture until they were older,
mm-hmm.
so that they could afford to give the time.
Right.
And that's a very big factor.
Yes.
Because it's a big financial sacrifice.
Yes. Now, something I had meant to ask you earlier when I was asking about becoming treasurer, your year was the first year that any payment was made for
that's
treasurer.
Correct. That's correct.
I'm trying to think of the amount.
It was $50,000.
Right.
Yes.
And in 1983, would that have been considered a great deal of money?
Well, I want to tell you, both years that I was treasurer,
mm-hmm.
my income as a practitioner went down $100,000 a year.
Mm.
So the $50,000
yes.
didn't
yes.
compensate for
no.
what I lost.
No, no. And we talked earlier about your work in the legal education committee. I wanted to also ask you about the Munements and Memorabilia Committee. You were involved in that?
Oh, yes. Well, that is the person who deserves so much credit about that committee is, and it was always sort of a joke.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you were appointed to that committee and everybody would sort of go ha-ha. And Regina Tate, who
mm-hmm.
was a lay bencher, who was just a superb lay bencher.
Mm-hmm.
Some of the lay benchers have just been outstanding.
Mm-hmm.
They've made such a contribution, and they're like a breath of fresh air, and she was one. She got in there, and she, of course, she's interested in history. She was a former teacher. She started looking, and what she uncovered was remarkable.
Mm-hmm.
And she came and said, "Do you realize what you have in this society?" And some of the treasures that she literally uncovered that were molding away in the basement. And she was the one who was instrumental in having a curator appointed
right.
to start documenting our assets
mm-hmm.
and cataloging what
mm-hmm.
we have.
So when did this have been, the 80s again?
This was in 83, it was in the 80s.
Right. Oh, so you were treasurer.
That's right.
Yeah, right,
when I was treasurer,
right.
and of course I encouraged her because history is my hobby. And she also was the one, when we had decided to have stained glass windows
mm-hmm.
in Congregation Hall, she personally raised the money to have those windows installed.
Mm-hmm.
She went to the law firms, she went and persuaded people to give, and every one of those windows is dedicated by somebody.
Yes.
And she was the one who arranged it.
Right.
And her contribution was just incredible.
Mm-hmm. Were you involved with the stained glass windows at all?
Yes, I was there when we had to choose the, I met you know, the various people
mm-hmm.
that were looking at, and we were the ones they brought in the designs that we looked at
right.
and chose the designs.
Right.
We had one design that came in that was all sort of modern, like a modern painting.
Right.
And we said that's well and good, but that's not the Law Society.
No.
And the windows, as you know, are very traditional
yes.
and historic.
Yes.
And,
so did you, as a committee, set the themes that you felt were important to cover, or was that up to
well,
the artist? How did that
the play artist, out? The artist had it,
mm-hmm.
brought them, and then the committee
right.
Approved them.
Right. And you were on the committee at that time
I was treasurer,
yes.
so I was on every committee,
right.
so I was involved. In
right. Right.
Yes.
Right. And can you think of some of the more important or interesting records, historical records that were uncovered at that time?
Well, you know that after I had been treasurer, convocation room had had painted turquoise, everything, including the wood, and it had satin suede drapes that were just filthy, and window curtains you couldn't see out, and I had been trying to get someone, and when I was treasurer, Barry Pepper was very careful. He was chairman of finance about spending money.
Mm-hmm.
And when I stopped being treasurer, I went to Arthur Skates, who was the acting treasurer, and said, Arthur, we have to do something about this room. It's a disgrace. So he appointed Joe Carthy and me as a committee of two to renovate a convocation room.
Mm-hmm.
And the architect was, I'm thinking of the Harvick it was, and he said, you know, we'll get the wood cleaned, and I think the room is beautiful now.
Mm-hmm.
But there was the one window facing south, and where the other window should have been, there was a bookcase that was locked. And I said, let's get that bookcase out, let's get the window back.
Mm-hmm.
They tore up the bookcase to discover that behind the bookcase there was a brick wall.
Oh.
There wasn't a window. In any event, the architect was very embarrassed. But when he opened the bookcase, which hadn't been opened for who knows how many years, they discovered in it two books. One was a handwritten diary of Lady Simcoe, whose husband, John Graves Simcoe, was one of our first governors of Upper Canada back in the beginning of the 19th century.
Mm-hmm.
And this was a handwritten diary. The other thing they found was a book inscribed to Osgoode Hall, Toronto, in memory of my dear late husband Albert, signed Victoria R. And we have that book. Various things
mm-hmm.
that they found in the basement, old silver that had been just was black and,
right.
and marvelous things.
Mm-hmm.
So
all that has been pulled out, and there's an archivist in place, and a
that's right.
library, or well, it's an archive store.
That's right, and there were a lot of papers that were now have been preserved.
Right.
But the person who certainly was the instigator of that and behind it and who deserves 99% of the credit was a lay bencher, Regina Tate.
Mm-hmm. Now, we've talked along the way today about different individuals who have served with you at the Law Society. We talked about Ken Jarvis and a number of benchers and former treasurers. I was wondering if there was anybody that we had missed talking about that you would like to.
Well, the ones who were very dedicated and
mm-hmm.
made great contributions, there was Barry Pepper,
mm-hmm.
and it was always a pity that he was never treasurer. He would like to have been, but he was never elected.
Right.
And he would have been a superb treasurer. He made great contributions to the Law Society. Stuart Tong was elected treasurer,
mm-hmm.
and he was a great supporter. He was a great supporter of women in the profession.
Mm-hmm.
And as you know, he was an outstanding tax lawyer in
mm-hmm.
his day.
Mm-hmm.
And he was always a great supporter of me, encourager.
Mm-hmm.
Brendan O'Brien, I have mentioned, and you will be interviewing him. It's a great pity you couldn't have interviewed Stuart Tong because he was a wonderful character.
Yes.
George Finlayson.
Mm-hmm.
You will interview him.
The other, Alison.
Yes. Yes. Well, George is a friend and a great fellow.
Mm-hmm.
George is younger than I am. I've known him since we were very young. You know, there have been some outstanding people there
yes.
who have given hundreds. hundreds and thousands of hours in the law society. And it's quite remarkable what they have done.
Yes. The one, I guess two other names I was thinking of that I have here, Gordon Bargerson and John Arnott.
John Arnott has, of course, he wasn't there. He had already gone to the bench when I became a bencher.
Right.
And he was an outstanding counsel in his day. And he has been back since he left the bench. And once again, his contribution is, you know, he's a very wise man. And these are very experienced people.
Yes. Yes. And Gordon Ferguson?
Gordon was a very faithful bencher. Even as a life bencher, he was there all the time. And you know, when one considers that he had to come 80 miles for every convocation and every committee day, and he seldom missed, when you consider what they day.
Yes.
You know, and this is all pro bono work.
Yes.
You're not paid for it. It's remarkable. And he was very sensible. And of course, he knew about small law firms. He knew about rural Ontario and what was needed for the public's interest in small town, small city Ontario.
Yes.
So the contribution of people like Gordon Ferguson is incredibly important for the law society. And you know, I think of people that we have from London. We had Jim Wardlaw from Orangeville. Well, Sam Lerner from London, who was a wonderful person, a great venture. You know, from small cities and small towns.
Yes.
Because it's quite different from seeing the profession and the public if you're in Toronto.
Yes.
And they understood and brought a perspective. It was very important. And the thing, the sacrifice that the out-of-town ventures make is just incredible.
Yes.
More than the Toronto ones make.
Well, I wanted to... Sorry, have I cut you off?
No.
No. Was there anybody else that...
No.
I wanted to ask you finally about the... as a final issue, the changing role of the Law Society over the time that you have been involved as a bencher and treasurer. So, and in fact, over your professional career, I guess. I wanted to ask, I guess, how you would characterize the changes. Obviously, it's bigger, it has more administrative functions. Some of the functions are different, and some of them are the same, like discipline and education.
We have become the one area where there's been a great change in disciplining is in sexual harassment. This was something that one never heard of 30 years ago. And I suppose it was bound to come with the increase in the number of women in the profession.
Right.
And there has been many more discipline hearings involving sexual harassment or sexual interference. thought of 30 years ago.
No.
It just didn't exist. It might have existed, but it was never brought to our attention. The other change that I see, I think that when I first became a venture, we were much, convocation was much more involved in the functioning of the law society. It was much more, I suppose, hands-on.
Right.
A lot of the functions that were carried out by convocation have been delegated to the administration.
Mm-hmm.
I think that that, I suppose, had to come when we had not simply 500 orders, but 30,000.
Yes.
And I think sheer numbers has necessitated
yes.
that. I don't think it's an improvement,
mm-hmm.
because I think that there were a lot of very wise decisions made then.
Yes.
I think that there's a lot more, when you go into convocation now, there's a lot more talk about policy and rather than in our day, in the, you know, years ago,
mm-hmm.
when you went in and you talked about the very basics of
right.
You know, practicing law and what
mm-hmm.
should be done.
Mm-hmm.
I think, it's my view, that it was better the way it was than the way it is now. Anyway, that's my age, probably. I think that the public was better served, that the ventures were able to keep
right.
a very close eye on the very practice of law.
Yes. But as you say, a profession is so much. The
bigger.
Numbers are so much, yes.
Well, that's true. But the one area where we have certainly lost out is in unauthorized practice.
Mm-hmm.
And we always used to, if people were practicing law without a license, calling themselves paralegals or whatever,
mm-hmm.
the law society was in to prevent it.
Right.
And this is very much in the public interest, because if you're not a lawyer, you shouldn't be practicing law. And what happened a few years ago, someone decided that why should the Law Society be spending money prosecuting people for practicing law without a license? It was up to the government, so they stopped doing it. And paralegals, of course, the government did nothing. And it's now become almost a sub-profession.
Yes.
And doing terrible work. And it's not serving the public. And it's no financial saving, because they charge as much as a lawyer or
yes.
more, in many
yes.
cases, for terrible work.
Mm-hmm.
And they draw wills that are an abomination in most cases. Well, because they don't know the law behind it.
Yes.
You can't draw a will unless you have a basic understanding of family law, tax
mm-hmm.
law, all
mm-hmm.
kinds of law.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, any of my clerks who were in the State Department could draw a will, but they wouldn't know the law behind it.
Yes.
So, unfortunately, the unauthorized practice of law
mm-hmm.
has really gotten out of control.
Mm-hmm.
And we had that silly report of Mr. Justice Corey a few years ago.
Right.
I don't know whether you read it or not, but
mm-hmm.
I did. And it could only be written or made by someone who had never been in a small law firm practicing law and dealing with the public.
Mm-hmm.
Of that was that the Attorney General, a couple of them, have been on the point of enacting his recommendation into law. Well, it's not going to hurt me. mostly the new Canadians who don't know the difference are very badly hurt.
Yes. Now, I've pretty much come to the end of my questions for today, and I was wondering if there was something that I had missed that you would like to raise about your experiences as being treasurer.
Yes, well, I must say it's been a very fulfilling experience. It's the sort of thing, at the end of the 2 years that I was treasurer, I was absolutely physically exhausted. It was the hardest 2 years of my life, but it's the sort of thing you're glad you did it, and you're glad when it's over.
Yes.
But it's a very satisfying a mentor and to have been treasurer and to think that you may have made some small contribution in the public interest, one hopes you have. And I would do it again. But it is a great sacrifice.